Well, hello there, and welcome to my first Facebook Live. I hope you can see me. It looks like we're doing okay, but I'm never sure with technology. So if you are watching and you can see me and hear me, if you could give me a thumbs up or a comment, just tell me that you can hear me loud and clear and see me as well. And I'm going to try and see if I can see myself as well on my other monitor here. So just bear with me for a second here. Make sure we get everything going properly. And we will have some company today, probably. My two cats are up with me here, Tika and Charlie. So if you hear any noise in the background or any crying, that will be them. So hopefully I put the fireplace on for them. Hopefully they will settle down in front of there and not bother us too much through this session. So I've had lots of different questions from you. And I can't cover everything, of course, in one session, but I'm going to hope to go through a few of them and provide you with some information. Okay, looks like we are live here, I think. We're good. Let me just see here and double check. Okay, so hopefully, like I said, you can hear me and see me. So before we get into things a little too far, I just wanted to invite you, if you haven't already joined my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, to do so. You can find it at www.facebook.com/groups/ChatterboxQuilts. It's a bit long, but if you just search for Chatterbox Quilts on Facebook, you'll also find my page or you'll find the group, and you can always join us there for different discussions on quilting and vintage sewing machines. So the other thing I wanted to mention before I got into things is that you may or may not have received a download from me that is about a multi-purpose quilt spray. So this is something I started off, it was a basting spray, but I found it does lots of other things as well. So that is a really valuable piece of information. I have a free download that shows you how to make it and different uses for it as well. So if you haven't got that yet, if you go to my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook page, you will see on the left sidebar, it says free quilt spray download. I can see it up there now. So if you click on that, you will be able to get that and be able to make your own basting spray. So this is great for basting quilts, so you don't have to use pins. And if you use a vintage sewing machine to do your quilting on, you know that pins can sometimes damage the beds on them. So this is a much better way to go. It's also great if you have a digital cutter because you can use it to stiffen fabric. It makes it a bit stiff when it's dry, so you can use it to stiffen your fabric, and then it cuts much easier in a digital cutter. So that's another use for it. And I have some more that are coming out, and you'll see some videos on my YouTube channel with some other uses for it as well. So check out that download. If you haven't got it yet, go to my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook page and look on the left sidebar, and you'll be able to see it there, and you'll be able to download it from there. So some of the things that I have had questions about, and I have to look at my notes here, so if you see me looking down, that's what I'm doing. There's been different questions about sewing machine tune-ups. Some people are wondering about free motion quilting and where to start and tips on that type of thing. So first off, let me tell you, I'll share some of my information, my experiences with you. I am not an expert. Yes, that's what I said. I'm not an expert. I don't consider myself an expert. I consider myself sort of like a jack of all trades. I know a little bit about a lot of things, or kind of, I guess, a medium amount about a lot of things. So I like to share that information with my subscribers and my viewers. But, you know, I encourage people to try the things I suggest. They may work for them. Hopefully they will, because they work for me. But I always encourage people to look elsewhere too. So to get as much information as you can and try different things out, and then you can go from there and work with what's best for you. Hello, I'm seeing Cazares AR. Hello, thanks for joining me today. Good, now I know somebody can see me. Yay! Okay. So as I was saying, you know, I don't consider myself an expert. I will give you some tips that work for me, and hopefully they'll work for you too, but I'm always open to more suggestions. So if you have other ways you do things, please let me know. And that helps me to learn too, because we all want to continue learning, right? That's the whole point of being in this group, is to learn different things about quilting and vintage sewing machines. So, oh, thank you. Sorry, it says she loves my videos. They're super informative. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I have fun doing them. And just in case you don't know, I am the talent in front of the camera, but my husband is really the talent behind everything. He is the one who films for me. He is the one who edits all my videos and everything. And if I didn't have him, I wouldn't be on YouTube. So, sorry. Angel, there we go. I was going to say, I thought Cazares maybe was your last name, so I guess I was right. So, hi, Angel. Thanks for joining us today. And now I know for the future, too. Okay, so let's get started with some things about, general things about sewing machines. Okay, so, you know, it's pretty basic, but sometimes people forget the basics. So when you're sewing with your sewing machine or when you're quilting with your sewing machine, you want to make sure that your equipment works well for you, and it's not going to work for you if you don't look after it. Okay, so before you start sewing or quilting, you want to make sure you clean your machine. And it doesn't take a lot. It just means that you need to make sure your bobbin case is cleaned out, that there's no lint in it, that there's no threads caught in it, any of that type of thing. So take it out, usually wipe it out. If you've got a bobbin that you can take out, a bobbin case you can take out, wipe it out. You'll also notice that where the thread feeds through in the bobbin case, that there is, there's a little spring in there. But often I will take a business card and just slide it in there and pull out. Sometimes you'll get a bunch of lint out of there that you can't really even see. Or you can take a straight pin sometimes and that will work as well. So make sure your bobbin case is clean. Wind a new bobbin. Of course, I like to start my projects with a new bobbin. If you need to oil your machine, make sure you oil that, excuse me, when it's suggested by in your manual, because that's important to make it go. And if you have a vintage sewing machine, that is a critical part. You got to keep those machines oiled. You don't want to over oil them, don't get me wrong, but you know they are mechanical. They need that oil to work properly and not to cause any problems. So check your manual. That is really the most important thing you have for your sewing machine is the manual, because it tells you everything, right? So once you've got that done, you also want to check the tension discs so you can clean in between them too. And just to let you know, most people, and I know I do it as well, when you're changing thread, I will just take the spool off and just pull that thread right out. And you're really pulling it backwards through the tension disc. Not a good idea. That's not how the machine was made. You're better off to snip the thread at the spool and pull it down through the machine. That's really how it's supposed to be done. So that's just a little tip that will, you know, is better for wear on your sewing machine. So, as I said, clean the tension discs. And the other thing, too, I want to mention is, you know, don't be stingy with your sewing machine needles, okay? A lot of us are going, oh my gosh, I don't want to have to buy more needles. I can just keep using this. No, no, don't do that, okay? Buy a new needle when you need it. Buy a package of needles. Make sure that you change needles. If you've been sewing or quilting for a while with one needle, it's probably time to change it. And sometimes, I know on my machines, it'll start making this kind of a thunking noise. And it's definitely time to change the needle then, okay? So if you're wondering why you're having problems and you're getting skip stitches or loops or things like that, and it's not your tension issue, it could be you need a new needle, okay? And sometimes needles aren't perfect either. So sometimes you may get a bad needle in a package. So if you're having lots of problems with stitching, first thing I try and do is I will change out, you know, I'll rethread the machine, but I'll also change my needle because it could just be a bad needle. So that's something else to keep in mind. And something else when you're working on a project, and I see this so many times, if you are using old thread, if you're using 20-year-old thread and you're having problems, well, I'm not surprised because, you know, there have been so many improvements made in the quality of threads in the last, I don't know, 10, 15 years. If you're using vintage thread, you're not going to get a good result, okay? Vintage is great in sewing machines, not good in thread. So use newer thread. I'll say newer because if you've had it for a couple of years or so, that's fine. But use good quality thread and good quality needles. The difference in price between them isn't that much. The difference in the quality of your project and the ease of creating your project is huge. So don't scrimp and save on those things, because I'll see people having problems and they're using really poor quality thread. Once you change out to a better quality thread, problems disappear. So, you know, you spend a lot of money on the fabric in your quilt, spend a little bit of money on the thread and the needles to make sure that you have good quality products and you'll get a much better result and a much better time creating your project too. Okay, so next thing I wanted to talk a little bit about is we are talking about needles. And this doesn't sound like a very interesting topic, does it? But it's a crucial topic. So I went to Schmetz Needles, SCHMETZ needles.com. And they have lots of information, actually, about needle sizes, about different types of needles and what they're used for and that type of thing. So I would recommend that you go and take a look at them. Okay, sorry, my screen's blanking out on me here. Okay, so what I got from them is, like, you know, when you buy the needles and they're in the little packages and they have all these different numbers on them, you're trying to figure out what they mean, okay? So actually, I have to do a little bit of reading here so I can tell you properly, is that in 1953, they went to a standard measurement for needles and you have an abbreviation of NM, which is a metric size, number metric. Okay, and most of us are in metric these days, unless you're in the States and you're still not on metric, but in Europe and Canada we are. So actually that NM that you see on the needle packages indicates the diameter of the needle blade in hundredths of a millimeter, measured above the scarf or the short groove, but not at any reinforced part of the blade. So when you see like an 80, 12, like an 80, the NM 80 means that it has a blade diameter of 0.80 millimeters. So that's what that means. So that was kind of interesting because I did not know that. And then they have a classification system of needles as well. So the most common ones you see is 130-705H, which in German means scarf. So they all have a flattened shank. It says for perfect positioning of the needle in the needle bar and in relation to the point of the hook. Excuse me. So that's what you'll see for your household sewing machines, your domestic sewing machines. And then, of course, you have all different types of needles as well. Okay, so, you know, sometimes you don't think that that makes much of a difference. You know, I'm sure a knit needle will work just fine on quilting cotton. Well, it doesn't work very well. Different needles are made for specific types of fabric and specific types of sewing. So it's really important to get the right one. So since we're talking about quilting, they actually have a quilting needle. Now, I must admit, that is not typically what I use. I do have quilting needles. I do use them when I'm actually quilting my quilt sandwich. But typically I like to use Schmetz needles, and I like to use their Microtex sharps, they're called. And those are actually for thinner, finer fabrics like silk, and it says woven microfibers and foils, things like that. So they're not actually made for quilting cottons, but I find they work very well for me. And when I'm piecing, I'm usually using an 80-12 needle. I usually use about a 50 weight cotton thread, so that's what I use. But they also have quilting needles. And it says that they have a slim, acute point, which is slightly rounded, in order to penetrate thick layers of material easier during quilting by machine. So they recommend this for quilting, whether you're actually quilting your quilt sandwich or even piecing. They actually ask you to use that too. So that is some information from Schmetz about the type of needle. Now, of course, there's other types of needles, and if you're using metallic threads, of course, there's a special metallic needle as well. So that's important to use for metallic threads especially. But you want to make sure you match up your needles with the type of fabric you're sewing, the type of sewing you're doing, and the thread as well, of course. Because if you have a thicker thread, maybe a 30 weight, and you're trying to run it through a smaller needle, maybe a 70, it's probably not going to work very well. And you're going to have fraying and breaks and things like that. So, again, if you go to Schmetz Needles, they will recommend different size threads. And also, I looked at SuperiorThreads.com. Superior Threads are very good quality threads, and I like to use their threads for quilting a lot of the time. So they have charts where you can actually look and see what type of thread goes with what type of needle and what application is best for that thread as well. So that's very helpful. So if you go to SuperiorThreads.com, they have lots of videos and downloads and education for you on threads. Now, the other thing to consider when you're talking about thread is the delivery system. So how is it coming off the spool going through your sewing machine? Because that's important, and that can cause problems too if you don't do it correctly. And I always have to look, because I always forget this myself. So I always have to write it down and look it up every time I'm working with a different kind of thread. But if it's wound parallel, where the thread's just going around, it doesn't overlap itself, it just goes along the spool, that is called parallel wound. And if it's wound like that, it should be placed vertically. So hopefully you have a vertical spool pin you can put on your, vertical spool pin on your sewing machine. Of course, that's what they typically are. The horizontal is what I'm thinking is that you need to get extra sometimes. And so that really works for most threads, and except for cross-wound threads. So those are ones where actually they go over and they overlap across each other. They go like this on the spool. They look like that on the spool. And those ones should be mounted horizontally. So those are ones you want to have an extra pin horizontally, and you have a spool cap on the end to keep it on, because if you don't, it just goes flying off. So that is something to consider too. So again, if you're having some problems with your thread when you're stitching, if there's a problem, one of the things to check out is your needle the right size, and is your spool of thread placed properly for delivery, if it's delivering the thread properly on your sewing machine or not. So those are a couple things to keep in mind. And then of course, you want to make sure your tension is good, right? There's lots of things, isn't there, when you're sewing. So how do you see if your tension is good or not? Well, if you're sewing along and you can see your bobbin thread on the top of your quilt sandwich, that's not good tension. You want your tension, you want your threads, I should say, to meet in the middle of your quilt sandwich. That is good tension. So if you have a drop-in bobbin, you may not be able to adjust your bobbin case. The machine does it for you, and typically you won't have too many problems with that. Let's hope. If you have a front-loaded bobbin, then you can adjust the tension. And how do you know how to get the tension right? And you notice I'm talking about the bobbin because that's where I start with my tension. I always set my bobbin tension first and go from there. So how do I know if it's good tension or not? How do I know how to set the tension? I take my thread, I take my bobbin and put it in the bobbin case, and I will, you know, wind it through just as I normally, the normal delivery system I would use, and then I put it on the palm of my hand, and then I will pull the thread up, and the case should stand upright, should stand vertical. Not necessarily leave my hand, but just rest on it. Okay? If you pull up the thread and the bobbin case is coming up off your hand, the tension is too tight. Okay? If you have the, and you put the bobbin case flat like this, I should say, so then it's going to turn like this. If I have the bobbin case flat and I pull the thread and the bobbin case doesn't move at all, it means that the tension is too loose, so you need to tighten it up a little bit. There's a little screw in the bobbin case, you need to tighten it up a bit. Okay, so that's something that's really important. So if you can set the bobbin tension yourself, that's great. And then you know that that should be set, and the only thing is to look at is your top tension, should you have any problems. So again, if the bobbin tension, bobbin thread, I should say, is on the top of your quilt, you're seeing it coming up, then that's a problem, and it means you need to loosen your top tension. If you have loops on the bottom, that's your top thread coming down, it's not tight enough, you need to tighten it, pull it back up again. So sometimes you have to play a little bit with the tension when you're first starting to quilt or sew, but that's okay. I always have little practice sandwiches so I can test my tension and make sure that my threads are running the way they should and that I like how they look and stuff as well. So that's always a good thing to do too. Okay, let's see here. All right, so if you've got your thread in, you've got the right needle in, you've got a new needle, your machine's clean, you're ready to quilt, right? Well, no, not really. Okay, you might be ready to piece, but you're probably not ready to quilt. So if you're quilting, that means you're using a quilt sandwich. And I have quilt sandwiches that I make up, just little ones, and layer cakes, like 10-inch squares are good for that size. And I have them at the side of my machine. So when I want to start quilting, I will practice on them first. Whether it's the shape I want to practice, or again, I'm checking the tension on my thread, that's what I want to do with those particular little sandwiches. So, you know, you might think that's a bit of a waste, maybe, but not really, because later on you can bind them if you want. You can use them for hot pads. Maybe they're big enough for a cat or a pet bed. I say cats because that's what I have, at a pet bed. So, oh, hi, Jean. How are you? Good to see you. So, you know, but that's good to practice. It's always good to practice first, and it gets you relaxed a bit. It gets you into the rhythm. It gets, you know, because a lot of people are really tense when they want to quilt and they're, and that's not going to be good. So you need to relax. Work on the practice sandwich. Doesn't matter what's happening there, right? So it takes all that stress out. But there's a few other things you need to do to set up your machine. So I will show you, or tell you, I should say, what I use and how it works for me. And you can let me know if you have any questions about that or what you may do instead. So there's a few things, tools I have that I need to have when I'm free motion quilting on my domestic sewing machine. Let's move this bit here. Okay, so one of the first things I like to have anytime I'm doing stuff on my machine is my manual. Okay, remember I said before, manual is very important. So I make sure I've got my manual there because it'll tell me how to set my machine up for free motion quilting. Okay, so what I do on my machine is I will turn my stitch length down on the machine to zero. Okay. Then I may turn down, drop the feed dogs, I should say. Okay, it depends on the machine. Some machines actually like to do free motion quilting with the feed dogs up. But if you turn the stitch length to zero, you know, it's not going to move anywhere, so you don't have to worry about it. So if try your machine, maybe it does a better job with the feed dogs up. Okay, so that's what you need to do with the machine. And most importantly, you need to change the foot on the machine, right? You need to have a free motion foot or a darning foot. And some machines have more than one available. I'm always looking for one that has the most visibility so I can see where I'm going. Okay, some are open, some are like a little C sort of, and they're like that. And they're kind of like a little C shape. And they're good, but sometimes if you're working on a quilt that has applique on or something, that little open area can get caught in the thread, so you need to be careful about that, but you can see where you're going really well. So I'll leave that to you with your particular machine to see what works best for you. So when you've got the machine set up, though, there's still some other things that you need, and I've brought some of them up to show you. So one of the things that I'm never without when I'm working on my domestic machine is the Supreme slider. Okay, this is a slippery piece of kind of Teflon-y stuff. That's what it looks like, and I'll talk about a bit about what you're going to see, what you see on this. It's pink on the back, and it can get fuzzy and stuff. It can pick up lint and fuzz, so you need to wipe it off just with a damp cloth and dry it. Mine, I don't know if you can see this well enough. Let's see. Can you see there's a little stitching? You see that stitching going up there? Yeah. Sometimes it doesn't stick really well, and then it gets carried along with your quilt, and that's what happens. So it doesn't ruin it or anything. It doesn't look very attractive, but it still works fine. But what I'd suggest you do is that if you tape it down to your, whether you've got an extension bed or whatever you have around your sewing machine, tape it down to that, and then that way it's not going to move and go anywhere when you move your quilt. So that's one thing I use. I just got this one. It's called the Sew Slip 2. That's a tongue twister. This is actually made in Canada. I haven't tried it yet. Really good price point on it. And I got this from stitchintheditch.com. I like to order online from her out in Vancouver, or BC, I should say, British Columbia in Canada. So I want to try that one because it's a good size and it was a very good price, actually. So that's one thing. The other thing that I want to have is I want to be able to grip that quilt, right? So I use machingers. You've probably heard of those. So here's my little, so they're little gloves. Sorry, my computer keeps shutting off. I'm going to have to change that. Okay, very attractive. I have seen some people cut off perhaps the index finger, third finger, and the thumb, so it's not as hot, and then they can change their needle or fuss with their threads or things like that. Those are washable, although I never seem to wash mine anyway. The other thing that's really handy in your bobbin is these little guys. I don't know if you've seen these little Genie Magic bobbin washers. It's a real mouthful, isn't it? They just help to prevent little thread nests on the back. They're just a little disc, and they fit into the bobbin case before your bobbin does. I don't know if you'll be able to see these or not. Oh yeah, you can see them. Just these little guys, they're really thin. And they're very economical, not very expensive at all. And I find they work really well too. So that's just something else that's kind of different than what you normally would use. Yeah, they are kind of interesting. And I got some for my, I have a long arm machine. I have a Handy Quilter Infinity, so it's a big one. And I just got some for it as well. I haven't tried them, I think I've tried them once, I guess, maybe. But I figure they can't hurt. Right? So they may solve some problems. Certainly I haven't had any issues using them. So yeah, that's another thing I use. Let's see, what else do I want to tell you? Oh, there's something else that you often forget on your domestic machine, actually. If you have a straight stitch needle plate, you know, so it's just a little hole in the middle of your needle plate, that is much better for quilting because it just goes down into that little hole. You don't have the play in the needle, right? Whereas if you have like for a zigzag stitch, needle plate, where the needle can actually flex back and forth, you don't get as good a stitch quality. So if you have a single stitch needle plate, then I would suggest you put that on and use for your machine. Oh yes, and Michaela says she can't live without these. I know, I don't either, right? I always have to have them on there. I find they're really great. That's the only ones I found I really like. There's other things you can use too to move your quilt around. I find the machine grips work really well. And you can get them easily, and they're not that expensive, so that's always good too. Okay, so let's see, you're all ready to go now. The other thing, and this is actually the reason why, I have a Janome 8900. I also have an older Bernina, but the reason I got the Janome, one features I didn't have on the Bernina, is a speed control on it. So when you're free motion quilting, be able to set the speed, like you reduce the speed down, but put the pedal to the metal, I say, push your foot pedal down all the way so it's going as fast as it can, but because you've reduced the speed on it, it's still manageable and everything. But that way you don't get this where you're going faster, slower. You can just put your foot all the way down. It runs at this constant speed. Then you can get in this real rhythm with your hands, right? So that is a feature that I have on the Janome 8900. I absolutely love having that. It made such a difference in my quilting, which is still not really, really, really good. But, every little thing helps, right? So that's something else. If you have that on there, that's really helpful. If you also have a needle up-down feature on your machine, and most of them do, put it in the needle down position. So when you're quilting and then you stop, your needle's going to be down. You're not going to lose, it's not going to have a jerky little stitch thing coming off that when you start quilting again. So that's also really handy. Okay, let's see here. Oh, and something else that's really important. And you don't think of these things, right? But most of our machines have an extension table on them. I'm lucky enough that I have a cabinet which has all kinds of room, and I can flip up a piece behind it and actually, have all this room where I can support my quilt, because that's important too, right? If your quilt is falling off the edge of your table, it's pulling down, you're not going to get good results when you're quilting. So that's something really important. Now, if you don't have a cabinet like that, because not everybody does and they're expensive, you can put like a portable table next to it. I know some people put like clear plastic containers at the end of their sewing machine, like off the extension bed, that are about the same height. And just something that supports most of that weight of the quilt will help a lot. Or if you're like me, if you're having really struggling with your quilting and that, you buy a long arm machine. But anyway, it's not really a good suggestion. You really want to work on your domestic one first and get good at that. Okay, so let's see here. The other thing too, and I talked about this at the beginning, I don't know if you guys heard this or not, but using the multi-purpose quilt spray that I have, right? I'm going to have my quilt sandwich basted using that. If you haven't heard about that before, it's a recipe you can make up yourself, and there's a free download on the side of my Facebook page, my Chatterbox Quilts Facebook page, for the free download. And you can just make it up, easy ingredients. You spray your fabric, put it together. It's like a temporary basting spray, and you can let it dry naturally, or you can iron it. And I would suggest you put some parchment paper between the fabric and your iron so you don't get your iron messed up. And then you will have your quilt sandwich all basted like that. No pins to remove as you go along or anything or get caught on. And that works really well. So that would be the other thing. Of course, you have to have your sandwich all ready to go. Okay, now, people were asking about free motion quilting. Where do you start free motion quilting? Well, everybody goes, well, just start. Well, it's always so intimidating, right? Everybody's always nervous and all that kind of stuff. And really, what I found is you do have to start, but you need to practice different shapes. And you have to get in the rhythm. And it's, you have to find your own rhythm, right? It's that match between the speed you're moving the quilt at and how fast the machine is running. And that's a practice kind of thing, but it's kind of like, if you're relaxed enough and you get going with it, it just kind of clicks all of a sudden, I found. And, it took me a long time, and all of a sudden I kind of went, oh my gosh, it's just working. And it's just good, and it just feels good, right? So after that, I didn't even struggle or stress about when I was quilting. Everything just worked really well. So I don't know if it was a new Janome or what, but anyway, everything seemed to work really good. So anyhow, you do have to practice, and you do have to start somewhere. So you start with getting your machine ready, like I mentioned already, getting good quality products, needles and thread, and just start. But your hands, this is muscle memory. Your hands and your feet get used to working together and everything. And what really helps is if you are tracing some designs first. So if you have a whiteboard, you can use pieces of paper, but you'll go through a lot of paper. So if you have a whiteboard and you can just draw, and I would start with circular shapes. Circular shapes seem to work really well. I think I start with like a spiral kind of shapes, but people will talk about doing like an E, right? Like a written E, or C is to go up and back and then up and back and up and back and go along like that, or swirls. I love swirls. Swirls, go in and then you come back around and then out and you go up the next one. Those are easy, but working on a whiteboard with them for a while and you just draw and draw and draw, then you come to your machine and you're moving your hands the same way. So practice on some of those quilt sandwiches to move along. And like I said, try certain shapes. So whether you want to do E's, just do E's all over the place on a quilt. Like if you've got a quilt that's something that's going to be on the couch or something, you don't need to worry about how well it's quilted. Nobody notices those things except you, or if you put it something in a show, I suppose, a quilt judge. But I mean, even mistakes you'll make yourself later on when you go to look at the quilt, you won't be able to pick them out, I guarantee you. So You know, the thing I have to keep in mind, because I'm terrible about starting things and not finishing them, is if you never get around to quilting these quilts, you never get around to using them, you never get around to enjoying them. So you really need to start somewhere and just try a design and work with them. Now, having said that, because that sounds so easy, doesn't it? But for a little more help on where to start, I have a number of books. So let me just pull these over and show you. There's some newer ones, some older ones. I have a lot of books. Like, I have over 400 quilting books, so I have a lot of books. I love books, any kind of books. But reference books are the best, right? So Angela Walters, everybody's heard of Angela Walters. She has several books out. This is one of her first ones, Free Motion Quilting with Angela Walters. So this is a really good reference book. Again, she is doing a lot of stitching in the background, you know, on the modern quilts and that. So a little bit different than going around appliques, for example. But she has lots of good ideas. You know, with Angela, she kind of goes, she will do one design and then kind of gradually transition to another one. And that's also cool because you get a chance to use several different designs in a quilt. So if there's some that you find you're starting to do and you don't like them so much, you can move on to something else eventually. Okay, what do I got here? Oh, I've got a couple of these. This is her, I don't know if I brought the other one up or not. This is her Shape by Shape collection too. This is one of her newer ones, so more designs and stuff. And so this is actually going into certain shapes. So you can see she's got in the diamond shapes or triangle shapes. So she's showing you how to fit designs into those spaces. So that's quite helpful because sometimes you don't know what to do in some of those spaces. And if they're bigger ones, you know, you can do a lot of things with them, but she gives you suggestions on what to use in those types of shapes, squares and circles and things like that. So that's kind of cool. Let me see if I've got, here's the first one. I was going to say, I know I had the first one somewhere. So she's got actually two books out on this. This is the first one. And then the other one is number two, same thing, Shape by Shape, but lots of good designs in there. Good reference. Natalia Bonner has a good one. Beginner's Guide to Free Motion Quilting. That's a really good one. So you're starting out free motion quilting. This is a good one, and lots of shapes that are doable for beginners too, right? I think the problem a lot of people have is they want to create those kind of show quilts they see, and they get so intimidated because they can't do that right away. Well, of course they can't, and neither could the person who did the show quilt. I guarantee you, without practice, you're never going to get to that level, right? Everybody starts from the same base, right? It's something new, something they're doing. Some people are artistic and they're, you know, they're artists and maybe they have a little more knowledge about how to create those shapes or designs or something like that. But I mean, really, we're all starting in the same place. And if you practice and practice and practice, you will get as good as some of these show quilts that you see, I guarantee you. Just depends on how much time you want to put in practicing. So, and this is a good one, just came out recently from Pat Sloan. Teach Me to Machine Quilt. This is good because she teaches you with the basics. And the interesting thing about this book is she starts out with walking foot. So you start learning quilting with your walking foot, which is really the easiest way to go, right? And different designs you can do with that. And then she moves you into free motion quilting. But again, simple designs here, lots of good information. I have a book review on that too. If you look on my YouTube video, you'll see some more about that particular book. And this one as well, Angela Walters and Krista Watson, another great quilter. The Ultimate Guide to Machine Quilting. I see where I'm putting this. There we go. So this one's really interesting. I like this one because Angela Walters is showing you how to do it on long arm. And Krista Watson does her quilting on a domestic machine. So she's showing you that. So you can see how they're doing it on the two different machines. And some types of designs work better on a domestic sit-down machine than on a long arm. So that's interesting too. Like, you know, everybody says you can do designs on both. You can, but some work a little bit better. Oh, Jean's saying he loves Harriet Hargrave's books. Oh yes, I didn't bring up any here. I have Harriet Hargrave's books too. Yes, she's very good. She's very good. These are more recent ones, I guess, than what I have. But yes, you're right. I do have her. She has one machine applique as well. Excellent reference book. It's one of my favorite ones to go to all the time. And her quilting one too is really good. I mean, I can only bring up so many at a time. This one is, I think it's out now. It's Free Motion Machine Quilting 123. This is Lori Kennedy. I got my hand in front of her name here, sorry. And this is all different designs. But what I liked about this book, and there's a review coming on this one soon too, is it's spiral bound or ring bound. So it lays flat. I thought that was brilliant. I love that because you could put it by your machine and use it for reference, right? And it's all color-coded for different types of design. She has the book divided into different types, like loops, lines, spirals, that kind of thing. So each one's color-coded. So you can go, if you're looking for a leaf design, for example, you could go to that section and, and find a leaf design. So, but she's got a lot of great information in the beginning of this book about machine quilting, free motion machine quilting. That was really kind of unexpected in this book. I thought we mostly, it is designs, there's a lot of designs, but she's got some really good basic information too in this book. So that's really great as well. So those are just some of the ones that I brought up that I have. I have other ones too, but those are kind of good ones for free motion quilting and for beginners to get into and learn. But I am a real proponent of learning either whether it's through videos online or books. I do buy a lot of, like I said, I have a lot of quilting books. A bit of a pack rat. But anyway, but for reference, right? Like, so if I'm looking for a design, I want to be able to go and look for different, you know, different books have different types of designs in them. So I do that, and different quilters do their quilting a different way. So, you know, by reading different ones, you can see how they do it, and maybe that's something that'll work really well for you, right? If you limit yourself to one person or one book, you know, maybe that's not the best method for you. Maybe those aren't the kind of designs you like, really, you know? So I always look around, and, you know, if the new books are coming out, I'm always looking at them and to see what ones I can add to my library, because as I say, when I'm quilting or something, I haul out several of them and I'll take a look and see, and I'll go, yeah, that design will work perfectly on the quilt I'm doing, right? So having a choice is always good. So I think that's about all of the information. I have all these papers here, but I think that's mostly information that I wanted to tell you about today. I'm just trying to see if there's anything else here. Had some other information, but I'll put these links, like I was talking about Superior Threads and Schmetz needles and things like that. I'll put those in the description of the video after it's no longer live. It'll still be posted. I'll put it up in the group, actually, so people can watch it there too. And, you know, if there's any questions that you may have at that time or any questions you have now, you can certainly type some in and I'll do my best to answer them. Oh, Michaela's talking about Kara McTavish. I was just about going to mention her. As a matter of fact, I have all her books. Yes. Yes, McTavishing is really cool. A lot of these quilters, too, I'm finding with, like, modern quilts, or she does whole cloth quilts, too, is they will use a lot of background fillers. So that's great. I'm always struggling to find designs that work really well around applique, because I like to do applique, like fusible web applique. I don't do hand applique. But I'm always struggling to find those, because sometimes I find those background fillers, some of them work, some of them don't. Depends on how much applique I have. And, you know, I can go to back to traditional cross-hatching or things like that too, I suppose. But, yeah, that's why you need to look at different books to see the style, depending on the kind of quilt you're working on, right? But McTavishing is great on, you know, just scrap quilts or you know, if you've got a lot of background you're trying to fill. You know, I've done some of her work on my quilts for sure, and she has interesting designs. Her book on whole cloth quilts is really, really cool. I haven't attempted that yet. That's a lot of thinking. I think I like to do my way of quilting is I like to do something that is easy to do but looks complex. Those are my favorite designs to do. I tend to get bored easily. And that's probably why I have a lot of UFOs around the house. But, you know, my friends come over and go, my gosh, haven't you quilted that yet? I'm going, no, but if you want to take it and work on it, go ahead. So, yeah, that's one of the things I want to work on, is to get more time to do that, to get back to actually finishing things, right? And I think if I look at things as a whole, it seems like it will take a long time to do them, right? So if I look at a quilt and go, oh, my gosh, it's going to take me a few hours to quilt that. But if you realize that you don't have to do everything all at one time, right? You can break things down into chunks. And actually, on my YouTube channel a while ago, I think it was, gotta be over a year ago now, I guess, I did a series on 15 minutes a day. And so it's what you can accomplish in 15 minutes a day, because so many people tell you that they don't have enough time to do things. And we've all got the same amount of hours in a day, right? We have different responsibilities, but, you know, somehow you will find time to do the things you really want to do. So in 15 minutes a day, it's surprising what you can get done. I'm also bad at my binding. Okay, I hand bind all my quilts. I do a good job on it, apparently. But I always think it's going to take me forever and ever and ever to do. But yet when I start to stitch the binding, you know, hand stitch the binding down, I find it doesn't really take me all that long. And if I'm sitting watching TV or something, it's, you know, hey, it's done already. So then you wonder why I was putting this off for so long. But anyway, having said that, I just finished a couple of quilt tops that I had sitting around for probably 5 or 6 years. One was just an applique that I had to put on it, and stitch down the edges. And, you know, again, once I put it down, it didn't take very long. And I don't know if any of you saw the One World Quilt Along that we're just wrapping up right now. If you search One World Quilt Along on Facebook, you'll see it. But that was a fusible web applique, 7-month project. It's really 6 blocks, but 7 months altogether. And I was finishing that. I was doing some of the blocks in it in between surgeries. I had eye surgery. I had 3 eye surgeries in the last 5-6 months. So in between, when I'm recuperating, I was filming and actually finishing and filming, I should say, some of these blocks. And they were probably, you know, I do machine applique. I do fusible web applique all the time, raw edge applique. But sometimes I don't finish the edges. And this one has so many small pieces, but I finished all the edges because, you know, I was doing one of the samples for it. So I had to do it, right? But I was like, wow, this takes a long time to do it. But on the other hand, it was also surprising to me on how quickly I got those blocks done when I actually really had to, right? I work best with a deadline. I don't know about the rest of you, but deadlines, I've never failed a deadline yet, whether it's for a magazine or, you know, a pattern sample, whatever. I'm not even really right down to the last minute even. So I get them done in good time, but that's what makes me get my projects done. If I don't have a deadline, I can drag those projects out for years. They just hang around, but you know, thank goodness I have space enough to have them all there. But it is nice to have your projects done and have them out and display and that type of thing. So, but some of you guys that are watching me today, I don't know how you work. Do you find that you have projects that you put aside and don't go back to? Do you, some people start a project and take it all the way through and finish it? That's not me. I don't do that at all. As I said, I get bored easy, so I will have projects where I need to do piecing. I'll have projects where I've got the binding needs to be stitched. I'll have projects that I need to quilt. You know, some are just, I'm still cutting out fabric. I like to be able to get up in the morning and, or when I come home from work and say, you know, today I feel like sitting down piecing. So that's what I'll do, and I'll grab one of those projects. I am not good about start to finish. So if you're one of those people who can start and take it all the way through and finish, I admire that quality. I wish I had that type of personality, but I don't. And sometimes I think, you know, you fight with your personality. Now, Michael says, yes, you too, as far as what, that you don't finish it, you like me. You know, I think sometimes that I would try and finish things off, you know, try and go, okay, you know, you've got to focus, you've got to do this. And it's just, it's not fun then. Right? It's not fun. So I'm going against my personality, and that's not really good, I guess. So I've learned that, you know, this is the way I am, so let's see how I can accomplish things with the way I am. Sorry, losing camera here every so often. So, you know, it's not, I don't think it's, like, I think if you want to do certain things, you want to change the way you do certain things, and you can still fit that in with what works with your personality, I think that's great. But I think if you are trying to change yourself and you're finding you're really not happy, you know, you enjoy quilting better the way you used to do it, whether it was, you know, different projects at a time, then I think you should stick with that. That's your personality type, and just figure out how you can move through a project, you know. So maybe Tuesday I'm going to do some piecing on this project, and maybe I'm not going to touch it again until next Tuesday. And that's okay, because then you have some variety in between. I guess I like the variety, I think is what it is for me, and the fact that I get bored easy. So, and also it's good if you make friends with people who, you know, if you have friends who like to do the binding, for example, and they don't like to do piecing, it's good to team up with people, and then they can do the things you don't like to do, and you can do the things they don't like to do. And I think that works really well. That's a good way to work things too, I think. So, oh, and Jean says he has several projects going at one time. Yes, I mean, I know I am the kind of person where I buy fabrics because I like them. So I buy fabrics for a project sometimes too, but most of the time I see something I like and I buy it, right? And then I go, what am I going to do with it? And my husband always says, you know, you would spend less money if you bought fabric for a specific project than just buying this fabric, right? And he's probably right. But I do find that the fabric provides me with inspiration. I like to go through my fabrics, and sometimes I have projects I think about, and then I change my mind on what I want to do with those fabrics. Or sometimes the fabrics get turned back in for a charity sale or something like that, right? If I've had them too long and I'm not doing anything with them. But I think, again, that's a similar thing with my personality. That's kind of the way I am, and you know, I'm not going into debt buying fabric. So So that works okay, and I have places to store it too, so it's not hiding under a bed in a spare room or anything like that. I actually have places where my fabric is still barely fitting. I actually have a sauna full of full of kits, actually. It's kind of funny. They're all in rough, what we call rough totes, plastic containers, but I do have, we have a sauna that was in the house we moved in, and we just never really used it very much, so it has become a bit of a storage space for some of my kits, actually, and batting, because batting is, you know, takes up a lot of room, so I can put it in there, because in my house, it's all about having access to things. I have a studio downstairs, and keeping cat fur off my projects. That's a big one, because I have two cats, and they like to be with me, and they like to be on my things. As a matter of fact, one usually sits on my lap when I'm trying to sew. So I don't want them to have their fur all over my quilting projects, and heaven forbid if they get fur in the batting, I don't know how to ever get that off very easily. So things are either put away or, like, on my cutting table. I have a central cutting table and an ironing surface behind me, a big table. And I actually cover those up with old sheets. Okay, so because my cats will jump from the ironing, I don't want the fur on the ironing surface, obviously, but they'll jump from that to the cutting table, and the cutting table has a big mat on it, right, a cutting mat, and actually when they jump and land, and it starts moving, and the claws go into it, so, you know, they're going to wreck it. So I put old sheets on top, and I cover my stuff with old sheets, or if I have projects out, there'll be another sheet on top of them. Looks like we're moving away for a while or something, covering up the furniture, but then I can just wash those sheets, right, and it works really well. So I don't know if you guys have pets or not. Most quilters I know have either a cat or a dog, or both. And I don't know how they keep them out of their rooms or what they do with them, but, you know, my guys kind of run the household, so I just have to find ways around that. And I make sure I don't leave out certain things that they like to chew on. Anything plastic, they will chew on different things. So if you had, like, knitting needles or something like that, I wouldn't leave those out. I don't leave out, I use doweling a lot of times to hang my quilts up on the wall. I can't leave that anywhere. I have some that have lots of bite marks on the ends of them, so that's a bit of a challenge. But, you know, they're good company when I'm sewing. So anyway, that's about all I have to say for today. I've been on here for over 45 minutes, I guess. If you guys have any questions, I'm going to try and do this every week about this time. So if you guys have any questions, just post them in the group. And if you have any comments about today's broadcast, any information you have that I didn't cover or a way you do something differently, please post that in the group as well, because like I said, we are all here to learn together. That's the whole point of this group, is to learn together and share our knowledge and experience. And so I hope that you are having a good day. I hope you have a good rest of your day, rest of your evening. I know some of you are probably into the evening already, I'm sure. So I will be back in the group, of course, and next week I will be here again, and we'll see what the topic is next week and what we can talk about at that point in time. All right, take care and have a great day.